I'm quite literally just doing this for more of a testing purpose. Let's take a look here. Hit this sucker up here, huh? Whoops, let's do that. Okay. So here's an important question for you guys. Who likes the Teletubbies? Because I happen to think that they're bullshit. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? It's kind of fucked up. How am I gonna do this? You know what? Fuck it. I couldn't give a good goddamn, huh? Couldn't give a flying fuck. A big old titty fuck. Oh boy. Okay, now gotta test out the audio for this thing. Best method probably be to use these. That's open. I think that's key. And then maybe this goes up. So if I turn this all the way up. Background noise. That's just too tinny, so now we go here. That's not bad. Let's turn that up a little more. Okay. And that. And that doesn't sound bad, does it? It should be okay. All right. I mean, I just know that I've been having some mic problems for a little while. That sounds okay. Now, if only there was something that I could do to silence my mouse and my click-clack keyboard. Okay. Let's just get on to the morning bullshit, huh, shall we? So, you know, all things considered, I think that audio adjustment I just did is okay. Excuse me. It'll work. So who do we have here right now? That's sent. Not sure who Zets is. But anyhow, Michelin Guide Inspector said Inspector's wife, life is lonely, underpaid drudgery, driving around France for weeks on end, dining alone, under intense pressure to file detailed reports on strict deadlines. The guide has become lax in its standards, and some famous chefs are untouchables. Oh, really? So the people who do Michelin stars are like heavily overworked. What else we got here? It's not necessary. Bitch, why are you doing that? There's no fucking reason for this. Come on. Suck my clams. Shalala.
Dá uma balançadinha, pega o meio aí, bem baixo.
What happens here? Just gonna break something, obviously. These people, I'm telling you. Telling you. This is gonna bug me. Let's just fix that, huh? It's time to change. It's time to change. It's time to change, and it's time to change. I also got something else down here, right? Let's see. And that's what I wanted. And that's what I wanted. Fuck yeah. Yeah, that's all kinds of fucked up, isn't it? We're gonna just leave that alone for now. That's okay. Alright. No shit. So it's like the chemical is just so hot that it's essentially fire, which is really not really anything. Oh, that sun can fuck right off, man. Pretty crazy, dude. Holy Christ, that sun is fucking bright. Suddenly gay. Anti-Putin blogger has his throat slit in hotel room after vocally opposing the Russian president. Yikes. Oh God. It's awful. I really like the vest. Bill, I didn't know you were born in Cajun country, and I don't care. Oh, dear. Classic. Spring chicken is somewhat full head of hair.
Hey, yo.
Hey, Eric, how you doing? I'm literally just streaming myself doing my regular morning shit. It's initially just to test out audio levels and stuff because some things were bugging me for a bit. But now I'm literally just fucking around. How are you doing today? Doing good? Awesome, dude.
Big-headed bitch! You fucking five-headed fuck!
What?
Are these gentlemen bothering you, honey?
The fucking beluga-whale looking bitch!
Oh,
look at you on fucking steroids!
Violence!
Okay, that's enough. Create a Polaroid camera with CSS gradients. You don't? No? It's just like a total, waste of time, I guess. Find out some interesting facts, but okay, let's take a look at this. So this image of this camera was made completely with cascade style sheets. Physical components, colors, and sizing. So here they are just working out all the padding and shit. Like, this is pretty in depth. Translate into HTML, of course. You gotta build a structure. Got all your div classes, closing your tags off. And then he's got his bottom, which I guess is the bottom of the camera. Oh, fucking hell, dude. So wait, was he just working with a picture? Then overlaying it. No way. Okay. Like this code right here, it's all source code, so you could literally just copy and paste it right now into anything that could support testing out HTML and CSS. So they got all these colors. Oh, and they're gonna make the f yeah. That would be tricky. You need like 1 pixel by whatever width. Oh yeah. Okay, they got it. Fuck. This is like one of the craziest things ever. And this is the end result. Jesus, look at that. That's not even a lot of HTML either. Fair bit of CSS though. But you know what? It's just about getting the parameters right, and when you have that all set up, you're good to go. It's all just code. Be cool if it took pictures. That'd be the next step. That's really fucking cool. Okay, let's see. Oh, hey. Let's pop and open some beer. Somebody went for the motion graphic. When Dark Helmet is kissing Princess, what's her name there? I've seen enough of that. Let's go to YouTube for a moment, shall we? Let's take a look.
The older I get, the more I forget about what it was like to be a kid. That whole period of time just kind of disappears into this fog with precious few days standing out. Pizza parties, fights, and then there was this one time. I think it was in first or second grade. I got permission from the teacher to go to the bathroom.
Yeah, no. I need to see that movie.
I walk into the bathroom.
I haven't seen it yet.
To one of those tall, full-body-length urinals that elementary schools always had. And that's what I made a horrifying discovery. At the bottom of that urinal, mere inches away from my shoes, was a massive turd. A man-sized turd, so big that perhaps it was actually left there by a teacher. This completely blew my 8-year-old mind. I had never even considered such a possibility. No person would possibly leave a number 2 where number 1 belonged, yet there it was. Whoever that brave soul was, they created a memory that stuck with me for my entire life. They inspired me, taught me to think outside the box. I never did it myself, but I often thought about what it would be like. And years later, I found out that I wasn't alone. It was in late 2000 that a group of proto-shit posters, let's call them, got together for a very auspicious conversation on IRC. A number of topics came up that night, including the idea of pooping in a urinal. They all had a good laugh, but in particular, one of them just couldn't get over it. He thought about all night long, and eventually he just had to, absolutely had to register the URL urinalpoop.org. And shortly after, he would craft that.
That's some early internet shit right there.
Number one destination for all things urinal poop, such as this Space Moose comic. Space Moose, what the hell are you doing? What does it look like I'm doing? You can't do it in there. Oh, I'm so sorry. I must have missed it when you got your PhD in defecation. Or this comic from the Humor Archives. It's okay, I've got diarrhea. It also collected a number of short stories having to do with urinal poop. I'll regale you with this one entitled Shitter. One night, before a girls' varsity soccer game, some friends and I drove up to the game and had a pre-party in my van before the game. It turns out we were pretty late for the game, so we quickly downed around 6 beers each. Before making the trek up to the field,
be right back in a second, I'm just gonna top off my coffee.
The closest bathroom to the entrance we went in had 2 urinals and 1 toilet. My friend took the toilet, and I took a urinal. My other friend really needed to take a number 2, but the toilet was already occupied. So, he proceeded to take a dump in the urinal. After he was done doing that, we were all laughing beyond belief. And the same friend who took a crap in the urinal started to choke on his gum because of how much we were laughing. So, he then flew over to the toilet and threw up all over the place. Needless to say, we all flew out of the bathroom at that point. The next day at soccer practice, the door was propped open to air the sucker out. That poor janitor. In addition, it also linked to a website, urinal.net, which is a gallery of unpooped urinals. In a way, this was a little bit of a precursor to urinalpoop.org, which would eventually have a gallery of its own. But at this early stage, they had no pictures, and the owner was asking for some submissions. Send me pictures of poop and urinals, dammit. Yes, really. I have none. If I get any, I will post them on the page. Stop sending me mail asking for poop pictures. And if you're going around pooping in urinals, it's a dangerous world out there. But don't worry, because they weren't sending you out unequipped. This fecal project mayhem gave you instructions on the best way to get poop in a urinal.
For fuck's sakes.
In a urinal. The easiest way is just to drop trow in the men's room and press your hiney up against the urinal and let go. However, I can think of a few reasons you might not want to take this approach. For instance, there's the whole getting caught ordeal, or having a colon prone to stage fright. Not to mention, putting your ass into close proximity with thousands of generations of urine. With that in mind, I have devised the following not-so-clever and oh-so-easy plan. In the comfort of your own home, when you feel the urge, crap into a plastic bag. Ziploc would be a good idea. Sponsor post? When the opportunity presents itself, carefully deposit your offering into the porcelain altar of liquid excrement. Congratulations. You now have poop in a urinal. Take a picture and send it here. And in the unfortunate situation that you did get caught,
how that works,
suggestions on how to get out of trouble. The top X things to say when you've been caught pooping in the urinal. Can you get me some toilet paper? This one seems to be out. I keep slipping off these little seats. What the? Get the fuck out of my stall. I'm installing the new cakes. Didn't you hear about the guy at Starbucks who got his dick crushed in a toilet seat? Dude, I'm not gonna sit on the crapper seats. People piss all over those things. Ideally, these are supposed to be funny. And with his masterpiece finished, creator of urinalpoop.org shared the link in a few IRC chats and walked away, in his mind leaving it to be yet another buried treasure in the vast plains of the internet. Like the icy hot stunters, or Jeff Goldblum is watching you poop. But then, something unexpected happened. About a month after urinalpoop.org went live, its creator noticed a sudden surge of traffic. Out of nowhere, tens of thousands of people were looking at this website. So he went and checked his logs and noticed that all of this traffic had been coming from none other
nothing cheeky
than goatsea.cx. Yes, that goatsea.cx.
We're not doing anything. How you doing?
It apparently been posted alongside the world's most famous gaping butthole. And it was shortly after that that he received his first submission for his gallery. And now here's the thing. I don't know if I would get a strike for posting the uncensored.
I'm just having my coffee.
There's not even anybody that I could talk to at YouTube to find out, because that's how the system works. But I'm not going to chance it. So here's what I'm going to do. I'll be censoring the turds with the closest approximation that I can think of, and you can just be comfortable knowing that these pictures existed. Behold, the one and only
excellent
in the very first incarnation of the urinalpoop.org gallery.
I might get a little crazy today and brew a little bit more later.
Popularity was growing exponentially. It would actually lie dormant until mid-2002. According to the site's owner, it was a thread on the Something Awful forums that reminded him of just how funny it is to poop in a urinal.
A few days of hell.
Came back to his old creation and
gave what happened there?
Redesign, complete with a brand new logo.
Oh.
And thus, we entered the golden age of urinals.
That's a rough one.
The gallery had grown, and the site now had a philosophy section.
Only thing you can hope for is sleep.
Aspects of pooping in urinals. Rationale. Most of us have, at one point or another, seen a urinal. As objects, in and of themselves, they don't elicit much in the way of commentary. However,
so in case you didn't deduce the information, he is talking about how there's a website and, I guess, a community of people who specialize in pooping in urinals. So, last night and today has been the word. Oh, fuck. I'm sorry to hear that, dude.
When combined with fecal matter,
just try and, like, rub your, you know, nerves and everything and
just
do whatever you can to sort of subside the pain.
What would drive someone to do such a thing? Desperation? Showmanship? Desire to disrupt? General drunkenness? Indeed, the juxtaposition of these two otherwise ordinary objects is more than the sum of its parts. Thus, urinalpoop.org. Delivery. And this section was a restating of the original strategies for getting poop into a urinal, divided into two sections, brute force and covert strike. And finally, apology. Be aware that there is a darker side to urinal pooping. After the initial discovery and exclamations, thoughts inevitably turn to wondering who's going to clean it up. This section is dedicated to those brave and unfortunate souls upon whom the duty falls to extricate the poop from the urinal.
The duty falls.
Even for one such as myself, childishly fascinated by the phenomenon, the task is an odious one. I'm afraid I cannot offer much more than words of sympathy and an encouragement to try to look at the funny side of the situation. You'll look back on this memory and laugh, someday. At this point, the book of urinalpoop.org had become fleshed out enough that it could practically be its own religion. However, one cannot live on urinal poop alone, and inspiration is fleeting. Although the creator of the site, regaining his motivation from somethingawful.com thread, toiled late into the night, working hard like a Grimm's fairy tale elf making a fine pair of shoes. This would be the last time that he'd ever updated. Years went by, and at some point between late 2005 and early 2006, ownership of the URL urinalnews.org
Fuck, this is good stuff.
Was replaced by one of those weird placeholder sites. It now proudly sported the text, urinalpoop.org. What you need, when you need it. But perhaps the time had already passed for these kinds of websites. By 2005, we were already deep into Web 2.0, and RateMyPoo.com was providing a more elegant solution for this market. But in a way, urinalpoop.org was a site that kind of bridged the gap between the old world and the new world. I guess what I'm saying is this episode has basically been my No Country for Old Men. Anyway, thanks for watching, and if you like this episode, you'll probably like my Rotten.com video. Goodbye.
Yeah, good old Justin Wang. Good old Justin Wang. Let's see. What else do we have? Let's go red letter. See what they have. You know what? Just been playing GTA online. Okay. Right. Now, because Joaquin Phoenix just won the Oscar last night, let's go over the Joker.
Half in the back.
Moose in the house.
Oh, PS4. More casual.
Hey, Mike, did you see Martin Scorsese is trending on Twitter?
Oh, no, we lost Marty?
Oh, no, he's still alive, but people are very upset with him.
Why?
For being absolutely right about everything.
Oh, Marty, we've been saying for years that movies are now theme park rides.
Is that what all this 3D shit is going to turn movies into? Like theme park rides?
Are you riding this in the old car?
Cheeky.
Through the kitchen.
Look, Mike, if I'm going to
trust anyone's
opinion,
it's why I play video games.
It's not going to be Martin Scorsese.
Chances are I'm having a shitty time and need a distraction.
And the Wasp.
Trust the Twitter mob.
Always trust the Twitter mob. Speaking of which,
yes.
Let's talk about Joker.
My mother always tells me to smile and put on a happy face.
Spooky clowns scare me!
Joker, a film so controversial, Joaquin Phoenix didn't know how to answer a question in an interview and left for 2 hours. That's where we should start before we get into the discussion is
the hot button politics.
Well, that's the interesting thing, more interesting than the movie. I don't know how you feel about this movie. We haven't talked about it yet, but
can we call this?
Yeah, my grain is a little different. It kind of nags.
Yes, very reactionary, and that's. As someone that grew up a horror fan, it's weird to me, like, because that's what you always heard. There's the argument that, like, horror films, they're going to turn you into a violent psychopath.
This guy is, to my way of thinking, a vicarious sex criminal. He has very antisocial attitudes. I felt creepy sitting there.
Or before that, you had, like, Tipper Gore and her fight against music, the evils of music.
We have always talked about...
No, you're right. You're absolutely right. There's nothing else you can do.
But, of course... The highlight has been on the excesses that have been allowed to develop as we have tried to focus our concern on those excesses.
It's a satanic panic. And
satanic panic, all that stuff, and it's still happening to this day. People are still trying to blame movies on the world's problems and not people.
Movies and video games.
Movies and video games has been a hot button issue forever as well.
People have been crazy since the dawn of time.
That's true. That's true.
One out of every 100 people is crazy and will stab you or shoot at you.
Well, that's the...
Regardless of what they're exposed to.
Well, that's the connection with this movie is obviously people are thinking of the shooting that happened in Aurora, even though that was mishandled, and they were saying that the guy went there dressed as the Joker, but he didn't. He just happened to have dyed red hair.
Yeah, I think it was a police officer who misspoke and said,
"Oh yeah, that's the Joker."
Yeah,
but it happened during a Batman movie.
James,
but
something.
But I think he said he just picked that movie because it was an opening weekend and it was crowded.
Yeah,
it wasn't.
But it's like the biggest movie of all time.
He wasn't
the time.
Trying to be the Joker, and then so
it wasn't a statement. Yeah,
it all gets kind of like twisted up in the lens of the media.
Yeah, but that's what's been interesting in seeing the lead up to this movie is...
Sorry, that's just gonna bug me. What was it? Batman shooter James Holmes? Was it Holmes? Yeah, James Holmes. This guy. This fucker. Crazy
people
dude.
That hadn't seen the movie saying this movie is going to embolden white terrorism, or this movie is going to empower incels and all this stuff. And now the movie's out, and the movie is about the importance of mental health care and classism. And now all these people that were whipped up into a frenzy look like complete buffoons. And I think that's wonderful.
Yeah, well, your politics start to become confused here because, they're saying it's going to embolden angry white incels, which is usually, I think, attributed to, like, your right-wing, gun-toting nutjob, because incel, I didn't know this for the longest time, involuntarily celibate.
Yes.
That's what an incel is.
The people that are very angry at women and angry at the world for mistreating them for the things they deserve.
Right.
Which has zero to do with this movie.
No, it's more of a, it leans the other way where it's anti, I saw many signs people holding Thomas Wayne is a fascist.
Mm-hmm.
And so clearly those like protests with the clown masks were very similar to a lot of the protesting, like the, remember the 1%?
It starts, that's, if we're going to get
Occupy
into the.
Occupy Wall Street,
yeah,
that's it.
If we're going to get into the movie, we should talk about.
Counterculture protests.
Yeah, but the movie to me feels like it's very sloppy when it comes to all that stuff.
Yeah, it's vague.
It's vague. It's confusing. It feels like a teenage anarchist that knows he's supposed to be angry, but doesn't really.
You know, in a lot of ways, people, like, they just sort of pick their own ideals of what they think it is. And they just pick their own little opinions and they just run with it. They don't even, like, really look at what things are for what they actually are. And, yeah, like selective listening, you know? It's just... I'm sure there's an idiom or a phrase that goes along the lines of, like, you know, the loudest person in the room is probably the dumbest or something. There has to be a saying like that.
He understands things he's supposed to be angry about. The movie reminded me a lot, like, it's directed by Todd Phillips.
Yeah, just watch the movie.
Comedy.
Yes.
He did all the Hangover.
Appreciate
movies,
the story for
and
what
my
it is.
My reaction to this movie is very similar to my reaction to those, which is that it's sloppy, broad, and lacking any ounce of cleverness.
Like, not everything is a political statement.
Okay, I'm going to say similar. The final act of this movie I liked.
Yes.
But the rest of it felt like Baby's First Taxi Driver.
Well, that's the thing. That's why that's I true. Had that switch, is because I knew Todd Phillips directed this. And so we had seen all... I think we reviewed the third Hangover movie.
We did the second and the third.
We did.
Yeah, way back when.
And everyone went nutso for the Hangover. Hangover to me is sort of like in funny in the way like Dane Cook
was
funny.
Yeah, exactly.
Those people that like that.
Yeah.
Where it's sort of like Hangover was okay. We can't find our friend after a wild party. None of us remember. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's frat boy humor.
There's a tiger. Oh my gosh.
So crazy.
This crazy thing happened. Now this crazy thing happened. And then so when you start Joker, it immediately starts with him, like, putting on his makeup. He works as a clown temp agency.
I guess it's like the star taxi driver, but they're assigning, you know, you take this route, you take this route, but they're clowns.
Hire a clown for the day.
I guess.
And his first gig is holding a sign outside of a store.
Rent a clown.
Everything must go. It itself is thematic.
Yes.
It's for the movie. If you didn't notice that, we notice things like that because we're film experts. Everything must go is the theme of the film. And then that's exactly what happens to the Joker.
It's true.
At the end of the film. So teenage kids take a sign, and then they hit him over the head with it. And so you're literally being hit over the head with like this obviousness. Like,
yeah.
And then I'm in the first half, I'm like, am I supposed to care? I don't care about this character. Like, okay, all these, and then it's like, you know, all these bad things are happening to him. People treat him like crap.
Should we go through the checklist?
There's a checklist. Like,
the psychopath checklist in these movies. Lives with his mom, check. Fired from his job, check.
But it's not just guy down on his luck. He has serious, serious mental problems. And I think that's portrayed by Joaquin Phoenix really well. I think he's great in the movie.
I think he elevates the material, because I think the script is, especially his character, is very underwritten.
He doesn't, until that final act.
Spoilers!
I guess, yeah.
Well, let's get into spoilers.
When you bring me out, can you introduce me as Joker?
Gesher.
When he starts really ranting, because he doesn't rant. He's a very passive character. Everything happens to him, and until there's a transformation. And I think it was really well handled, like his slow demise and then rise to the Joker. Because I mean, what this is an origin movie.
Yeah.
That hasn't been that deeply developed. The Joker's always been mysterious. And in '89 Batman, it was just like he's like a common street thug. And then he falls in a vat of acid.
Yes.
It's crazy.
Hindsight is kind
and
of weak.
Ledger's Joker was always a mystery.
Which, is, in my opinion, is still the best Joker.
Sure.
How did I get these scars? And he tells different stories to different people.
Yeah. And that moment when Heath Ledger lights that giant pile of money on fire is just so great, because it's like, okay.
Yeah.
This guy's a true anarchist.
Some men just want to watch the world burn. Yeah.
Yeah. And, but the Joker, to me, has always been crazy, but
they were both really good, both Heath and Joaquin.
He's an anarchist, but he's able to rally people to his cause. He's able to outsmart Batman. He can't physically fight Batman, so he has to have that level of intelligence in order to outwit him. And then that was the first half of this movie, me thinking, like,
how's this guy going to do anything?
This guy's no match for Batman. he doesn't have all of his marbles.
Right.
But then the movie, and then also his love interest.
I saw this coming a mile away.
Well, I was stunned. Okay, spoilers. Spoilers. I didn't see the twist coming, but I didn't like that they were doing it. Because I was like, okay, there's this woman who lives on his floor, you know, and I'm like, why are you even associating with this guy who's a freak?
Yeah, they're me.
On that note, I'll be honest, the first Fast and the Furious movie, it had a lot of hype behind it, and I just didn't care. Too Fast, Too Furious, and the Tokyo Drift, I looked at them like as total shit, just garbage. Even as like a testosterone-filled teenage boy, I just did not care. But I won't lie, I have passively watched one of the newer ones. I'm not sure which one. There's been so many. I enjoyed them. They're all right. But I mean, like, you'll look at them now and you look at, like, say, like, it's delved into, like, Hobbs and Shaw, which is just Jason Statham and The Rock. It, like, has nothing to do with cars or driving anymore. And, I hadn't seen it, but I'd watch it just for the shitty fun of it all. First, because they actually had cars. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I can understand you being into that because you're definitely into that culture. But for me, it was just, I was like, okay.
Immediately friendly.
It just was.
His mom's in the hospital. She's there. She like kisses him.
I didn't hate it.
Right. I think she's had like.
But I also didn't love it.
What is this?
Yeah. There's one moment that kind of gives it away when he kind of pushes open her door and he starts passionately kissing her and the door closes, and I'm like, because he has fantasy sequences in his head before then.
Yeah.
But
see, that was disappointing to me, because if that if they didn't establish earlier that he has, yeah, delusions, and that was the first time we realized that, I think it would have been a bigger revelation.
Sure.
But it's like, we get the revelation, oh, she was in his head all the time. Them hanging out was in his head all the time. And it's like, yeah, but we already know he's delusional.
I just saw the newest trailer for it.
If we didn't already see that.
The fact that those two were...
You know what? We're going to just jump into the new trailer real quick. It's fucking... It's just... unrealistic scenes and stupid premise. Fast Furious 2020 trailer. Like Vin Diesel. Right. Vin Diesel, who looks like The Rock, is enemies with The Rock. For some reason, John Cena is his brother, and they look nothing alike. But
I used to live my life a quarter mile at a time. But things change. My father now. I will always be in your heart.
Little Brian, I have a gift for you. Your daddy gave me this. No, I'm gonna give it to you. It's very special. For protection from what's coming.
All right, Dom. What's next?
I mean, like, you know, there's some movies you can just put into a category of just popcorn bullshit. Like, it's like, don't think of integrity and clever thinking or just. It's like going down a hill on a slide. Just we, and then you're done. Master thief, assassin, high performance driver. Who is he?
Jacob is Dom's brother.
Your whole life, you pushed yourself. Smarter than Dom.
But could you kill him?
I don't know. They're gonna milk this dry. Isn't Vin Diesel like 55 now?
There's nothing more powerful than the love of family. You turn that into anger, there's nothing more dangerous.
Maybe this is the end, but we won't go out together.
You know I'd ride to the death with you.
I'll tell you, this film series, though, they really like to use up pro wrestlers as actors.
Strapped to a rocket engine?
Impressive. I know.
No. No, that's not impressive.
There's a laugh scene for everyone. Like, what is this anymore? Like, street racing. That's like a $20 billion jet.
Hold on.
Tell me you're not thinking what I think you're thinking. There's no bridge!
Oh, hell no.
I don't know who that is, but I'm assuming he's from an older movie. Yeah, so Yeah, Hobbs and Shaw was. Asian guy played Soon Kang. Okay. So the saga will end with this two-part finale. And then there will be spin-offs. Yeah. Well, I think the reason why the Hobbs and Shaw thing happened is because there was money to be made with that cast, but Vin Diesel and The Rock just did not fucking... Good try, Dan. Thank you for the bit. Oh, nice try, Dan. Nice try. Yeah, I don't know, man. What language is that? I have, I think I have the Icelandic guy doing my bit reads now. I switched it up a couple days ago. Sorry, I wanted to see Vin Diesel's age. It's 52, okay. I mean, you know. It's up there, but it's not quite that old. Yeah. Holy fuck, I got 3 notifications. Nobody cares. Okay, this fucking tweet I put out, it's been getting likes like crazy. I don't know why. I just said Ham Biscuit. We have a Ham Biscuit here, and it's got 61 likes and retweet. And it's just updating like crazy. I talked to the wrong people.
Giving them the time of day.
Yeah.
Was so unbelievable, but I thought it could happen in a dumb movie. Like at, you know, they were going to be on a date, and then they were going to get mugged, and then the killer was going to kill her. During the, and that was making me more crazy. Like, I thought that was a checklist, where it's like checklist. Oh, you know, his therapist that he goes to because he was in an insane asylum. The therapist gets her the public funding cut. So all these like hit you over the head, like all these bad things are happening to this character, and I thought that was going to be like the turning point.
She turns on him and then he flips out.
Or something. She gets killed. Sure. Whatever.
I think the thing, because clearly, I don't want to keep bringing up like Taxi Driver and comparing this to Taxi Driver, but it's so clearly inspired by that.
Yeah.
And like to me, because I didn't even think of this as like a Joker movie for most of it. It feels like an existing script that they then kind of like reworked to be a Joker movie by adding in like Thomas Wayne and stuff. But the thing that makes like Travis Bickle scary is that he can function normally in society. Mm. He feels like a normal person. He woos Cybill Shepherd, and it's believable, unlike him getting along with the girl. But then like he tries to take Cybill Shepherd on a date, and he goes to a porno movie, and he doesn't understand why she would be turned off by that, or why she would be upset by that.
You know, I didn't know that you'd feel that way about this movie. I don't know much about movies, but if I...
Let's see if I can find
Joaquin Phoenix's character is just sort of like, has mental problems from the beginning. So then there's really nowhere for his character to go for the rest of the movie.
Wrong.
Oh.
His character transforms into the Joker at the end because... I don't mind that he has mental issues. His mental issues are crippling to him. Mm-hmm. And I think, and that's where it started to get interesting to me, because most of the time I'm thinking, okay, he's a crazy guy. He gets beat up, and he gets, life's down on him. Everything's bad at him.
He tries to do stand-up, and he's terrible at it.
Now he's gonna put on this makeup and just start shooting people and become the Joker. Mm-hmm. But then we get that wonderful little story with... I love this actress. She was the mom on 6 Feet Under. She was in lots of American Horror Story.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Frances Conroy. Right.
Great actress, and I was pleasantly surprised to see her in this. She plays Arthur Fleck's mother.
Yeah.
Mother. And then we get this. She's writing letters to Thomas Wayne, you know, because she used to work for him. And then it turns out, like, and he goes and he investigates this, and I'm like, oh, we're getting something more is happening than. Just he's getting then the hangover plot, which is they gotta find their friend.
They have to retrace all their steps to find their friends, and then that doesn't lead anywhere. And then they just say, "Oh, I think he's on the roof," and then that's how the movie ends. Again, when I say lack of cleverness.
Yes, but that's where the movie started to add layers to it.
It took a long time to get to that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, but it's fine, though, because he was crazy, and then, I mean, real quick, I mean, without getting too much into it, his mother thinks that she is also crazy.
Has delusions, yeah.
And imagine she adopted a son and worked for Wayne Company, Wayne Enterprises, but she thinks she had an affair with the elder Wayne, what's his name?
Thomas Wayne,
and that he's a love child from blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And then it turns out that
she was just completely nuts.
It's almost like a Munchausen syndrome kind of situation, I think, because he's being medicated, mm-hmm. and then he goes off his meds. And that to me was like kind of when he got like set free.
Yeah.
And he became like the, because I was like, how is this guy going to be a criminal mastermind? But maybe he is underneath all that medication. And so
see, I wish they had built that
up
more, though.
They spent 2 hours building it.
No, they don't mention any, like, because they mention he goes to his psychiatrist, and she says, we're cutting funding, and, like, yeah. they're clearly commenting on, you know, mental health care.
Yes.
And so I thought it was going to be an issue with, like, oh, he can't afford his medication now or something, but nothing happens with that. And then just when his two clown buddies visit his apartment, he yeah. says, oh, I stopped taking my medicine. And it was just like that.
Well, really a major plot point is when he shoots the three guys on the subway.
Yeah.
One of which who looked
and also
very
the
suspiciously similar
therapist to the or whatever, or social worker.
Oh. Clearly commenting on the, you know, the wealth, kill the rich.
Well, that's another thing that felt muddled to me that we can get into.
That was a socialist slogan,
yeah.
kill the rich during the Bolshevik Revolution.
I think that was on a newspaper headline in this movie, too. Didn't it say something about kill
well,
the rich?
Well, it was questioning whether that was his motive.
Yeah.
And that's the comparison people are making, is this would be a rallying cry for the basement-dwelling incel.
Which it's not.
And, no, because those people are go out and just shoot people just to be awful. When you think about it, the Joker only killed anybody who, like, was awful and deserved it.
Yeah.
Like, he wasn't out just to, and even while all the chaos was going on, he's like, I'm not political.
Yeah, he says that when he's on De Niro's show.
I don't have a motive. I'm just crazy. And, he kills the three, like, Wall Street dudes on the subway because they're being, like, awful. They're throwing French fries at a lady. And
I think they're drunk.
They're drunk. Yeah. And then they start beating him up and kicking him. And rightly, he defends himself. A little too much.
A little extreme, but
and then he kills the guy who gave him the gun, his fellow clown, ratted him out.
Yeah.
He let the little person go because he was nice to him. And then his mother, I mean, she lied to him his whole life and
yeah.
kept him medicated. Mm-hmm. After that, he's crazy.
Classic sort of anti-hero stuff, but
yeah.
Going back to the three people that he kills on the train, I thought there was nothing before that scene to indicate that there was already some sort of revolution happening in Gotham, was there? There was nothing about, like, because it starts, it kind of feels like, yeah, Occupy Wall Street, but that's after his shooting, right? It makes
yeah.
it seem like that's the inciting incident.
It is.
But that's such a bizarre stretch to me, that a clown killing three people on a train that happen to be, like, rich businessmen, the idea that all of a sudden that inspires all the underbelly of the city, all the 99%ers to rise up. It felt very underdeveloped to me.
It's happened in history where an incident sparks a revolution.
I mean, maybe if they had built up to it. It sprinkle it in, like, grows and grows. It was like immediately they cut to hundreds of people rallying.
They did establish it by saying constantly, like the very first scene when he's putting on the makeup, it's the people on the news are talking about how there's garbage everywhere.
Oh, yeah. Well, you see
that. There's
a garbage
strike. And, you know, garbage men are in a union probably, so there's this sort of city funding issue. Mm-hmm. And he's like, this world, he's saying to his therapist, he's like, everything's fucking awful, isn't it? And she's like, yeah, yeah. And so you could feel in all the scenes are all gross and ugly looking, and there's all these problems. And it's you could feel that, like, that hatred of the rich guy. It's the complete inverse of the Batman story.
Oh,
that's,
sure.
That's another thing I liked about it, too, is that once you see, like, you know, Thomas Wayne as like a villain, to the common people.
Yeah.
He's rich. That all these people are rich in their tuxedos, and it's like they hate the rich stuff. And they're the bad guys. And inverse is Batman is, you know, the good people of Gotham. I've got to save them from those dirty criminals.
Right.
And you're taking that exact story and just polar inverting it.
Yeah.
And that's neat.
It's interesting to think because, like, I think that the character was really good. And you almost want to see more of it incorporated into the Batman world. But I think it would be a hindrance if they were to ever make another movie of that same character with Joaquin Phoenix again. Like, just one and done is probably the best way to go.
It's like... The super riots are after he kills Robert De Niro.
Yeah.
There is some
and
protests.
That felt like a stretch.
Though I would say I would like to see other characters kind of developed in the same way, with more Batman villains. Like the Riddler, he would be a good one, and maybe the Penguin.
I'm okay with that. You can't like build everything up perfectly.
I mean, you can. Plenty of movies have. I'm just saying that the storytelling in this was sloppy.
Is this a joke to you?
Once he became the Joker, though, that entire third act, him on the show, on De Niro's talk show, I loved all that. There's some slightly unintentional comedy when he's ranting and you see the little, like, Dr. Ruth type character, and she's just like, sitting next to him on the couch.
The Joker to me in this was scary when he became the Joker.
He becomes that entire last scene where he's on the talk show was like genuinely tense.
Mm-hmm. So I thought it built up to it just fine. I was disappointed with the obvious setups, and I thought that's what it was going to be.
Yeah.
But once they involved the backstory of Arthur Fleck, his relationship with his mother, the family secrets, all that kind of stuff, it gave it some thickness that I didn't expect. I thought it was just going to be guy who's insane, has life, you know, shit on him, and so he decides to go revenge and shoot people and become Joker. I really expected that.
Yeah.
So that I think that's why I was pleasantly surprised, because I was expecting the hangover of Joker origin stories.
There's a pull quote for the
poster. That would have been bad.
The hangover of Joker movies.
I expected that.
I know.
And it didn't quite give us that. As far as an origin story, good.
I have no idea if this is based on anything real, but his whole, like, uncontrollable laughing.
Oh, yeah.
I liked that, and I liked the scene. Do you notice the name of the comedy club? That's another obvious.
What was it?
John Wayne Gacy.
Call the comedy club Pogos.
Ah.
I think it's all just one shot where it starts on the other end of the room and it slowly goes towards him. And it's like he doesn't know when you're supposed to laugh at a joke.
Right.
He's just like randomly starts laughing. And like I loved that moment.
Yeah. And he's writing down like what a crazy person would do.
Oh yeah, you see his notes, and it's like the ramblings of a lunatic. Yeah,
and he's like, make funny about sexual stuff. People laugh at that.
Yeah,
like he doesn't get humor.
Mm-hmm.
He worked as the clown. He fantasized about the Robert De Niro talk show.
Yeah,
and then it led to father issues, and him performing in front of people, the kid, and then that's sort of like at the end when the mob pulls him out of the cop car, saves him because he's like a superhero to them.
He's made it in his chosen line of work.
He killed a symbol
of
1%, the famous talk show host.
Mm-hmm.
Played well by Robert De Niro.
Sure.
It's always nice when he shows up in a movie and tries. Still happens sometimes.
But then they make him, he stands up on top of the cop car or whatever. And he
starts dancing.
He's enjoying the spotlight.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like what he wanted. And that I think that was played a part with the stand-up comedian. He wanted attention. He wanted to be an entertainer. And it was just all buried beneath layers and layers of crazy, which was all like, set free at the end.
Yeah. I will say, even though I had issues with this movie, I liked the third act a lot. But the first part was kind of muddled, messy, but I applaud Warner Brothers, who we've had issues with recently, But I applaud them for making a movie that is like a big, wide release movie that is a stripped down, character driven mm-hmm. story. Mm-hmm. Even if it didn't completely work for me. More movies like this, please.
Do you mean specifically in the comic book realm, or
just in general? We don't get movies like this. Like, I would have liked this movie more if it wasn't connected to Batman, if it wasn't a Joker movie.
I think, in my opinion, the Kevin Feige Marvel Universe under Disney, that's its own thing. I think this artsy DC, it should be the reboot of the entire DC universe. Start from scratch right here, Joker.
Well, we do have to point out that this is because we've complained so much about the Zack Snyder attempt at super realistic Superman. Mm. This is not that at all. No. Those movies suck because they're so tone deaf and because they try to still have the big, over-the-top, like, headache-inducing action.
Yeah, those were pretty boring.
And this
boring.
Movie is closer in line to, like, the Christopher Nolan stuff mm-hmm. a little bit. It's not nearly as good, but it's definitely a lot, like, grimier, which is interesting. I want to say this is, like, lower budget than a lot of these movies, which makes sense because there's not a lot of effects. But if Warner Brothers continue to go this route, like, almost like the Blumhouse model, like, keep the budgets low, give it to real filmmakers, although I feel weird calling Todd Phillips a real filmmaker, but
he did a good job though.
He had a vision for this movie. So if they continue with that, I mean, you know,
just tell a good story.
An audience.
That's all you have to do.
Seen smaller scale movies, it's good for them because they cost less, so they can make more.
But I think this is a one and done situation, because how do you do this with Superman?
Well, that's the thing. The minute you have Batman show up, it'll look ridiculous in this.
Right.
The Christopher Nolan movies always had that problem. They always bordered on ridiculous anytime Batman started talking.
I'm not wearing hockey pants.
You'll forget about it forever.
I'm pointing the gun, Harvey.
But seeing just the Joker story alone and the origin of how he became a crazy mastermind, anarchist weirdo, worked pretty much for me. I mean, a couple of more, add some more complexity to the story maybe would have helped. Maybe remove some of the earlier, like, obvious things, but those obvious things, like...
That was a big hurdle for me to get over, was the checkmark stuff.
Once you jump over that hurdle, once they, like, that annoyed me when they revealed that the girlfriend was when he's in her apartment, and mm-hmm. she's like, who are you? Get out. You're that guy up from down the hall? And I was like, oh, yeah. But then they show flashbacks, and then I was like, oh, yeah.
Works in Fight Club. Doesn't work so well in this movie because it feels like it's, again, obvious. It's hitting you over the head.
Right. I was like, oh, I got it from when she said, aren't you Arthur from down the hall?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, my gosh, she was never there.
Yeah.
I mean, we didn't need all those flashbacks that showed that she was never there. The movie itself was pretty solid. I was unexpectedly surprised that I started to enjoy it halfway through. And like you said, it's a different thing. It's a comic book movie mixed with a little character study, and you don't see much of that these days.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to get your Man of Steel action. You're going to get a very, very, very long. Is Joaquin Phoenix in every frame of the movie?
Just about.
A wonderful role for him. Acting is a little hard out.
Yeah. It goes right along with his filmography of other movies that are just close-ups of Joaquin Phoenix's face. Mm-hmm.
So this movie is such a heartwarmer. I cried three times during the course of it.
I don't believe you've ever cried in your life.
What a piece of shit. Oh boy. Rich Evans. Movie. Trailer. 2020.
Hey everybody! Happy New Year! I'm Rich Evans from Red Letter Media. And now that we're living in the 20s, a beautiful new decade, we're going to celebrate the new year by taking a look at some of the trailers for all of the exciting movies we have to look forward to this year. Especially for January. All right, everybody, let's go have some fun.
Fuck you, it's January.
Ooh, that's good.
selling the house? Anyone help?
What's wrong?
We need to leave right now.
This is so 15 years ago. Does Sam Raimi know it's current year?
Hello?
Well, it's not really a new vision. I have a grudge against this movie.
So just an old woman opening her mouth is a jump scare now?
Well, they're doing the same scenes and stuff again.
It's a great start, but I'm sure they're going to get better now. Rehash something from 15, 20 years ago. All right. Well, what's this?
Get me the fuck out of this car.
Oh.
Mike, we got more time behind us than in front.
Yeah, please.
That Martin Lawrence died from a Walmart truck hit him. Is he wearing a fat suit in this? Like he did in Big Mama's house?
Thanks a lot. We got it, Marcus. We appreciate it.
Did they have to DH Will Smith for this, too? Gemini. More like box office cancer, man. This is so 15 years ago. Again.
I see trees of green.
Okay, this movie fucking flopped. Red roses too. And I think we all saw coming.
Get all those real animals.
Are you Dr. Dewes?
Bad Boys, I'm actually willing to give that a check out because I enjoyed the first two.
My digestion. At least this looks better than Noah.
Hello, Patty.
Robert Downey Jr. in a prison uniform. Where have I seen that before?
Yeah, no.
A little girl of super energy?
No real qualms with Bad Boys.
Well, at least they fixed the CGI Sonic. Now it's sure to be good.
Why are you hiding out?
Rise of Skywalker.
Isn't Jim Carrey like 60 years old now?
I didn't see that either. And honestly, The Last Jedi, I don't remember much from it. Oh yeah, it's just a fun movie. I mean, I enjoy Will Smith, and I enjoy Martin Lawrence.
One more time. What's up, my techno trolls? Get ready for the drop.
Jesus Christ.
Just do it already. Come on, man. One more
time. Is this a screensaver? Nightmare?
Yeah.
They seemed...
But also, Martin Lawrence is one of those guys who just disappeared.
If Barb collects all the strings, our music will be destroyed forever. We're gonna need a battle plan and weapons.
Violence never solves a problem, Branch.
There's a pit bull!
I'm going to give you five.
How this all works. Okay, Google. Is this real?
Oh, I'm so glad I'll be planking. I'm sorry, white lady, if I die on you today.
You gon' give us our company back.
He's not happy.
Oh god, the movies this year. I'd rather see blood in my stool.
Oh, Okay, let's see what else we can do. Oh, fuck. You know, it's actually funny, the guy we just saw. See this image right here of this guy? It's from another picture called Dick the Birthday Boy. From this image here. Okay. Now the funny thing is Dick the Birthday Boy.
Okay. I'm sorry, but I can't.
Julia Roberts was in the suit.
Dick the Birthday Boy.
Did you like steal my old family photographs? Is there like an album of mine in your possession? This is creepy.
How crazy of a coincidence is that, huh? Which is
when a new sub one more first accounts.
We've gone full circle, guys. We've gone full circle. Okay, we need some content. Some content. Well, first of all, actually, let's look at something here. Is there anything good coming out this year? 2020 movies? Birds of Prey. I don't know. I don't know, guys. Okay, this one actually looks interesting. Wait, they're making another X-Men movie? Like,
what's the last thing you remember?
Are they gonna do it right this time?
He said we had to run.
The reason you survived.
I think there's like 14 of them or 12.
You're not alone.
X-Men movies. There's X-Men, X2, Last Stand, Wolverine, First Class, Wolverine again, Future Past. Yeah, Deadpool is one. Apocalypse. Logan. Okay, Logan was good, to be fair. Deadpool. Dark Phoenix. And I guess the New Mutants? Holy shit, dude.
Not anymore.
Deadpool was pretty good, too. I enjoyed that. I didn't see the second one, though.
Would anyone like to share their first time? Brain.
I was 13. I thought it was a dream. I just lost control.
Sam?
I started panicking. People got hurt.
Roberto?
My girlfriend. I burned her.
Ileana?
I killed 18 men. One by one.
This isn't a hospital. It's a cage. We
don't need no. It's important we find out your power so we can help you get better.
I saw something I don't think she wanted me to see. I don't think we're here to get better.
This place takes your greatest fear and makes you live through it until it kills you.
I wouldn't really call this an X-Men movie.
Who's there?
Just a jump scare coming.
We can get out of this together.
I
my opinion, a forgettable mess of CGI.
Hey, I'm Miles.
This looks fun. This movie.
But instead, I grew up to be a nobody.
Another schism.
Schism picked random weirdos and made them fight to the death.
By the way, between this movie here and Swiss Army Man, shout out to fucking Daniel Radcliffe for making movies that are just like experimental messes.
And the internet loved it.
Yeah, it is. They had some early screenings a couple days ago here.
I think you have the wrong approach.
Whoa, who are you?
Look, this is gonna sound really fucking weird, but can you help me? I have guns bolted to my hands.
Yeah, you're right. That does sound pretty fucking weird.
You have 24 hours to kill Max. Fail, you die. Leave the city, you die.
What the fuck is Max?
It's showtime.
Don't shoot me! I don't want anything to do with this! These guys came to my house last night, they're making me fight. But I have a plan.
Go on.
You can stop trying to kill me. And kill Schism! You in?
No.
I almost feel like Daniel Radcliffe is just picking his roles out of a hat.
That's what we'll do. Relax and
stop running!
Mistakes were made.
10 million viewers, you have made history.
I never wanted any of this.
Like, personality that has to blank, that needs to blank.
It's over.
It's not over till I say it's over.
I wouldn't do that if I was you. You'll just end up blowing your damn face off. Then you'll still be depressed. Even more depressed, probably, because of your fucked up face.
Yeah. Alright, what's this?
My sister. After all this time, what brings you home?
Oh, yeah.
I'm on the run.
Black Widow.
I was trying to do something good. Any more than just a train killer. You're fooling yourself. We are still both train killers.
Guns Akimbo, late night Netflix, what the fuck is this watching?
Still fits.
Is he Russian American or Captain Russia?
Back together again.
You got fat.
Smell the water, Wayne.
Yeah.
There's a new world of widows. New enemies. I'm done running from my past. Who the hell is that guy?
Oh, stop it already. We already had Thanos. It's over. Just... it's done.
It's okay, baby. It's okay.
Yeah. Zombie outbreak, I'm guessing. Alien invasion? civilization's been gone for a while, I guess, or they're just in Detroit. Oh, watch out. Oh, you done fucked up. What is this, like The Last of Us, the movie?
I don't know why you came all the way up here. There's nothing left.
Please.
That's the guy from Watch Dogs. Yeah, it looks like Detroit, man. Cillian Murphy.
Odd. The people that are left are not the kind of people worth saving.
Part two. The fuck was part one? Aiden Pierce as well.
All you'd need and all you'd want. Number nine. Number nine is not a starter home. His house is forever.
Play for a boy.
Do you have children?
No. It's not exactly what we're looking for.
The fuck is this?
Strange.
Yeah. Wait. No, I don't think this is the right way.
Yeah, this is where we came in.
Number nine again. Did we just do some kind of loop?
How if we just...
Want me to drive?
Such a joke.
Because I think it's just not possible. We can't make turns like this over and over.
We have gone this way, Tom. Oh my god.
Okay.
Hello?
So they can't leave. Is this The Sims? Baby. He's childhood.
Give a little time for the child within you. Don't be afraid to be young and free. Open to the locks and throw away the keys. And
all we wanted was a home.
I'm a little intrigued.
You are home.
Vivarium.
Creepy little mutant.
Okay. That seems a little interesting. I'm not gonna lie. Fuck you, kid. Go have some cereal. And fuck off.
Right here. You gotta get your rhythm section under control. Your heart as the drums. Your breathing as the bass.
That's the easy part.
What's the hard part?
Living with it.
You can't
give your heart is the drums, your breathing is the bass,
the rhythm section.
When are you gonna teach me a fight?
It will take too long.
How long?
Menopause will be a distant memory. good start.
Wow. Well, like, conditionally, but, like, what? Like, you'd be susceptible to, like, what? The loud noises? Or, like, what's...
A life built on lies and indifference.
Dang, Radcliffe again.
And unless we got up from our privileged white lives and did something, our words were meaningless.
Hey, you!
Oh, okay.
You are sentenced to imprisonment for 12 years.
I was just thinking, like... I don't know. If you had to leave, like, maybe you could. But...
Don't give up.
We are prisoners of conscience.
Well, we're prisoners of war. I won't give up.
So, there have been attempts. Some go a little, some a little more, but no one go apt.
Always a first time. We need to get out of here.
Everybody comes in here, like, they're gonna break out of here by next week.
If you're having a plan.
Well, I'll tell you, like, I barely ever go to the theater myself, so... We make I probably haven't gone in,
crazy.
I love it. A little over 2 years now.
Searchlights covers every inch of the yard. Wars with guns.
Oh, no shit.
There is something, and I will find it.
That sucks.
Don't you ever sleep through my bed again!
Well, that, okay, I can understand that. And in all fairness, it's not the cleanest of places. Like, I don't even know if they disinfect the seats. In some cases, the public restrooms at the theater would probably be cleaner than the actual theater itself. Because at least those get cleaned. Escape from Tarkov. Wow. Antlers, things we wanted. Lovebirds. Okay. Okay. Let's check out something else now. How about that? See what's if anything's new on Reddit. Just real quick. Truth about Apple keyboards.
Some of the needs that you believe that writers should be asking for in the next round of talks with producers.
Apple needs to fix those keyboards. Though they are impossible to write on, they've gotten worse. It makes me want to go back to PCs, because PC keyboard, the bounce back on for your fingers is way better. And the hands up who still uses a PC. You know what I'm talking about. It's a way better keyboard. And those
well, it's any keyboard you want.
Horrendous. Especially as the computers, as the laptops get newer and newer. I mean, here's the latest new iMac. The keyboards are worse. And I've got some shoulder problems. I've got like a sort of ooze, I don't know if you call it over here, like this sort of thing here, which is that tendon that goes from like the forearm down into the thumb. You know what I'm talking about, you guys who are writing. And what happens is you open the laptop, and you're like this, so the laptop, you've just got to fix those keyboards. WGA needs to step in and actually do something.
Right, but in regards to that, if I'm not mistaken, Apple, their keyboards connect one of two ways. One is via Bluetooth, and the other way, I think, is just USB, so it kind of really doesn't matter. Just a thought. But still, okay. I mean, do what you gotta do. This one, yeah, he gets the fireworks. Classic. Pew! Oh shit, they fell off. No fucking way. What's this? 3 artists following me. I got an Oscar with a short film. Idea to go with this image. Get at me. Nailed it. Oh, because he won an Oscar last night. Interesting. This joke is stupid. Don't know about Max. Do they have yet again some sort of own stupid... You know, they might have some sort of, like, programming thing where it's, like, certain keyboards won't work or whatever. Which is kind of bullshit in a lot of ways, but that's the way Apple works, I guess. Yeah. I mean, I've never really owned Apple anything except for a laptop, like 9 years ago, 8, 9 years ago, and that was it. It was just for college, really. And you pack what you need. Yeah, put your doggy in a bag. That was weird. Let's go back to YouTube. Hit another video. €67,000? Are you fucking shitting me? Dude, that is way too much. That's way too fucking much. I'm trying to see if anything of interest is gonna pop up here, but I'm not seeing anything. And man, that sun is fucking bright. Justify that. Oh, fuck no. It's ridiculous. Come on. Be realistic. You'd have to be, like, stupid rich. Like, I mean, to the point where it's, like, inconceivable. Like, leader of a drug cartel kind of rich. Where did sound cards go? I have no idea. I'm curious about this.
Just Grand Theft Auto games are just full of weird secrets and Easter eggs. Some of them so obscure and hard to find it took years for fans to finally decipher them. Hell, some things still have fans scratching their heads, desperately trying to find the next clue that might not even exist. This is Rockstar we're talking about. They create worlds so detailed and realistic feeling that it's easy to think they could hide anything in there. Hi folks, it's Falcon, and today on Game Ranks, 6 Grand Theft Auto Easter eggs and secrets found years later. In Grand Theft Auto 3, there's a large section of the map known to fans as Upstate Liberty that's inaccessible through normal means. Really, it's just meant to be background scenery, you know, to make the world look like it extends beyond the boundaries of the playable portion of the game, just basically to make things feel more real. But we know gamers, if they see something in the distance they're not meant to go, they will find a way to go there. With some pretty careful use of the dodo, and remember this is Grand Theft Auto 3, that plan wasn't designed to be able to fly very far.
Yeah, look at the wings on that.
You can reach the boundaries of the map and fly through these hills. That was the hard part that took players a long time to pull off, and at this point, I wasn't able to find a definitive timeline of just when someone was able to get into the upstate area, but it took a while. Once you're here, the game becomes increasingly unstable. Freezing and crashing isn't just likely, it's pretty much certain as you go further off the path. Still, there's some pretty interesting stuff to find here, like the Cedar Ridge Observatory, which you can get a better look at. These spots up on the map can seem
it's too fucking bright, dude.
And the Ghost Town, a section of the map used for the opening cutscene of the game. It's actually a pretty interesting area to look at because the level of detail is actually higher than the regular game world. This may be because of technical limitations or maybe because the area was developed near the end of production. Either way, it's cool to compare some of the details in the Ghost Town to how Grand Theft Auto 3's map ended up looking. On Rockstar's website in 2012, they put out a statement regarding this area, basically admitting it was never meant to be found, but that they're impressed players managed to find a way to get there. Sure, wow. You can use cheats and mods to get there now, but back in the day it was pretty much just using the dodo or nothing, so the fact people were able to fly that thing for any length of time and find this stuff is pretty impressive. Like, I can barely get off the runway in that thing. And at number 5 in Grand Theft Auto 5, the Infinity Killer. This is a bit of an unusual one because the actual conclusion to the mystery was discovered fairly quickly. It's the details that took a little bit longer to find. During the story of Grand Theft Auto 5, you'll probably end up hearing an offhand mention or two of a serial killer from 1999 called the Infinity Killer, a pretty obvious reference to the Zodiac Killer, whose murder shocked the state and whose victims were never found. But you can find the bodies if you look hard enough. All 8 victims can be found in and around the small cluster of islands north of Mount Chiliad, all of them wrapped up in plastic or something along the sea floor. It'd be weird enough if the story stopped there, but random clues and information about the Infinity Killer can be found all over the place. There's a burned out house in Sandy Shores with weird scrawling on the remaining walls, stuff like 8 is just infinity stood up, and there will be 8. Look at some rocks near his home and you'll even find some more crazy man writing, this time a rhyme which seems to relate to the killer's 8 victims.
I never knew this.
Inside Boiling Brook Penitentiary, you'll find even more clues, like this graffiti on the recreation yard that reads, "Where water meets land and fire once spewed forth, the infinite 8 shall lay until I return," which points to where the bodies are eventually found. Probably the most mysterious thing in these bloody footsteps near the billiards table and the 8 ball. You can even find some barrels and trash cans with the bloody look 8 on them. It's all pretty spooky, right? So is there any more to this than surprisingly detailed world building for players to discover out there on their own? Probably not, but as we've seen with this list, that hasn't stopped people from speculating anyway. And moving along to number 4 in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas, some secret cheats. These were only recently discovered in 2019. Those cheats aren't actually from the original version of San Andreas. Rather, they're found in the mobile version of the game, which just so happens to be the same version used for Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3 ports. The developer of this particular version, War Drum Studios, added in cheats like the ability to skip missions, get certain weapons, become invincible, which surprisingly wasn't a cheat in the PS2 version of the game, and other really powerful effects. They were mostly added for testing purposes, but the keyboard shortcuts still work, you know, as long as you've got a keyboard to connect to your mobile device. The cheats themselves aren't actually that interesting, but the fact that it took around 6 years for someone to discover them is pretty impressive, and that just goes to show the lasting appeal and fan interest of this amazing game. Moving on to number 3, Grand Theft Auto 5's Cryptozoologist. Here's another Grand Theft Auto 5 Easter egg which took a while to solve. When Rockstar released the next-gen version of GTA 5 in 2015, they added a few new features. Mostly small stuff, but one of the weirdest things was the addition of peyote plants that can be found in some pretty random locations around the map. You eat some of it and, hey, you're now an animal. This lasts for a little while, then you turn back to normal. Outside of being a weird and amusing addition, there didn't seem to be a lot else to it, at least until people saw the description for this achievement, which you get for collecting all 27 peyote plants. That description is the cryptozoologist. You unlocked all animals for use in director mode, or did you? Director mode just basically lets you play as NPCs, be they human or animal, but the achievement implies there's some secret animals left to be found. Players began searching the game files for any graphics or audio files or scripts that may contain references to any undiscovered animals, and eventually found out about the existence of secret gold peyote, which only appears at specific locations on specific days and only between 5:30 and 8 a.m. and when it's foggy. Oh, and also they only appear if you're in the process of completing the mission, the last one, where you help out a Bigfoot hunter. And that only appears if you 100% of the game. So there's a lot of requirements for these things to appear. Find one of these incredibly difficult to find things and you'll get a vision of Bigfoot, and when you regain consciousness, you'll find a dead animal nearby. You'd think that'd be it, but after further digging into the game files, people discovered that eating the gold peyote in a certain order from Sunday to Saturday.
That's all new to me.
Event. During a hallucination as Bigfoot, you'll find the Bigfoot hunter from the last one down on the ground, and you can follow a series of bodies to the Thompson scrapyard where the beast will attack you, and it's Teen Wolf. You know the 1985 Michael J. Fox movie? It's a werewolf head with a varsity jacket, and that's what all this mystery's been leading towards. At least you unlock the beast and Bigfoot for director mode, so you get something for all the trouble, despite it all being completely insane.
There's a lot of this game that I haven't explored.
Two is the Bigfoot in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. The most famous
That's fake.
Easter egg from Grand Theft Auto San Andreas is, of course, the Bigfoot,
Isn't
the
it?
Mythical monster widely rumored to be found somewhere in the game's gigantic map. There had always been Easter eggs and secrets in GTA games, but with the huge size and ambition of San Andreas for the time came huge expectations for the fans for some really surprising secrets. And the supposed Bigfoot and the hunt to find it became the singular obsession of secret hunters from almost day one of the game's release. When the news hit about the hot coffee controversy and the hidden files in the game, people's expectation to find something only grew. Of course, in hindsight, it's easy to say that if modders were able to find the hot coffee files, then why didn't they find any of the Bigfoot stuff in the game's code, but for a long time, the possibility was there. Perhaps there's a phantom code that would only become visible when certain conditions were met. I mean, this is Rockstar we're talking about, so it's not impossible. I mean, technically speaking, it's not possible. In order to do that, you'd probably have to be connected to the internet. Most versions of Grand Theft Auto San Andreas had no internet connectivity, but whatever. It didn't take too long for people to claim they'd found Bigfoot when offering some ridiculous sequence of events you have to trigger to get him to appear, like going to Mount Chiliad at a certain time on a certain day under certain weather conditions, and there'll be a 1% chance you see a blurry silhouette or something. Eventually, modders started making their own Bigfoot models and porting them into the game for kicks. People were going Bigfoot crazy until Terry Donovan, one of the co-founders of Rockstar Games, set the record straight. He said, "There is no Bigfoot, just like in real life." This seemed to answer the question, but of course, this being the internet, some people just assumed that he was giving another cryptic clue. GTAMythsFandom.com suggests that Dan Houser, another co-founder and head writer on San Andreas, said in an interview Bigfoot was actually created for the game, but only released in beta. The problem being, this interview seems to have disappeared from the face of the earth and remains uncredited, so it's possible that a Bigfoot was intended to be in San Andreas and maybe even was in it in a beta. If you trust information that doesn't exist anywhere anyways, like you have to choose to believe a random unsourced statement in a wiki that can be edited by any person. There is a simpler but unfortunately less interesting answer, which is that there was never a Bigfoot in the game. Either way, the Bigfoot has certainly made an appearance in other Rockstar games like Red Dead Redemption, Undead Nightmare, where you can hunt and kill the last remaining Bigfoot in a pretty downer mission, and in Grand Theft Auto V, which was pretty much the same setup to the mission in Undead Nightmare, but this time you end up shooting a role player in a Bigfoot costume instead. But those Bigfoots would have never existed if there wasn't such an intense fan interest in finding Bigfoot in San Andreas, and it remains one of the biggest and most notable video game myths of all time.
Can't believe I'm gangbanging with Bigfoot.
And finally, at number one, the Mount Chiliad mystery. You know, from Grand Theft Auto 5.
The UFO thing, right?
The big one, the mystery to beat all other mysteries in the GTA series. On top of Mount Chiliad at the cable car station, there's a weird mural covered in some...
I don't know what this is.
A UFO, an egg, and a jetpack on there, all connected to what seems to be an eye above a mountain. Trying to solve this thing has been an obsession of a certain subset of gamers for nearly 7 years now.
I think the Bigfoot thing was more talking about San Andreas than it was GTA 5.
There's even an entire subreddit dedicated to figuring this thing out.
Yeah, this isn't an Easter egg. It's more of just a mystery.
Sure, and of course Rockstar isn't saying anything, so all anyone can really do is look at the facts and decide for themselves. What we do know is that progress on solving the Mount Chiliad mural went absolutely nowhere until the next gen release of the game. Early on, most people seemed to think that solving this mystery would unlock a jetpack for you to use, one of the most iconic, well, vehicles you can get in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. But after years of searching, no jetpack was ever found. What was discovered was probably what the red eye was supposed to indicate, as well as a message on the nearby observation deck that said, "Come back when your story is complete." If you beat the game and get 100% completion, then come back to the observation deck during a storm at 3 a.m. and a UFO will be there. Some people think that's all there was to the Chiliad mystery, and maybe they were right, but many weren't satisfied with that conclusion and continued to search for clues. Things never progressed far in those early years, not until Rockstar released the enhanced next-gen version of the game in 2015. In that, they added a few new cryptic clues that potentially pointed to more that could be discovered from the Mount Chiliad mural. Some of these, like the cryptozoologists, ended up being completely unrelated Easter eggs, but the search heated up once again to finally unlock the jetpack or get an alien gun or some kind of reward for all this effort. Well, in 2017, people finally got their jetpack from the Grand Theft Auto Online update called Doomsday Heist. In it, you find a secret bunker built under Mount Chiliad, containing nuclear warheads from an insane tech billionaire that wants to destroy San Andreas. So yeah, GTA Online goes places. But the main takeaway from this is that in the climax of the mission, you get a jetpack. So there seems to now be an explanation for pretty much the entire mystery. The eye on top is a clue for seeing UFO. The UFO symbol is a UFO. The cracked egg is a clue about the first Epsilon track, which is found on the observation platform after finishing all the Epsilon cult missions. Oh yeah, and a thing about the Epsilon cult is that they believe the world was hatched from an egg, so that's the egg symbol, and the jetpack, well, that was added to the game in 2017 with an update. Is that all there is to it? For a lot of people who still post on our Chiliad mystery, the answer is no. And on one level, I can't blame them for thinking that, because if it stops there, then the ultimate resolution for this thing is kind of lame for something that people spent so much time trying to figure out. On the other hand, Rockstar is never been above making an elaborate joke at the player's expense, so this whole thing may have been one big troll. Either way, it was pretty interesting stuff.
Enough of that!
That's all for today. Leave us a comment, let us know what you think. If you like this video, please click like and...
Okay. I gotta really open that up. GTA Online. Do some exploring, because it has been years since I played it. Years and years, man. Alien egg? See, I don't even know about that. What I do know about, though, that I was kind of surprised they didn't mention that is, it's just the fact that you can see an alien, excuse me, in the prologue mission, in the river, under the ice. Yeah. That was a neat little surprise. Trying to find something interesting here, something neat. Not finding anything interesting. Huh. Wait, what? Maggie's head is missing. GTA Online Alien Egg Bunker Mission. Okay. Let's peep that out. Legit way. Let's go with this one. Okay. Holy.
Here we go. Find the supplies and take them back to the lab. And make sure they're not too damaged in the process.
Timmy, you know how to get in the way, don't you, bud? Yeah, but seeing it randomly, though, like, it's very strange. Huh. Still kind of curious, though. That does it for my coffee. Not bad, because considering I started drinking coffee at 9:30 and it's now 2. Well, rather. Guess I'm going to carry on with some other things that I need to take care of for now. So I've been streaming this for about 2 hours now. Get Larry Lawton recommends as... Larry Lawton... The jewel thief there. This guy. Yes.
This is there.
Yeah. I found him a couple nights ago, actually. He did the review of the jewel heist, talking about how, you know, there's certain things that you would or wouldn't do. It was quite interesting. And then, yeah, I was listening to his stories about his time in prison and stuff, and yeah, it was pretty cool.
I'm here to review the want to go with it and nail it.
And he just kind of...
And look when they're banging it in. They're not even getting it. They're getting a few pieces. You know, it takes a little time to get the whole stuff. I would be in a robbery...
About a minute and a half before the alarm will reset itself.
I would be in a robbery for sometimes 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Take people down... I'm stopping it while he's doing the robbery, and I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
One robbery I did, I was in the store for almost 30 minutes.
Well, I remember him talking about how, like, when he was in prison, he was able to get, like, background information with lawyers and stuff to try and help out people with, like, legal, as, like, I guess a counsel. But also because he was a prisoner, if there was somebody who was, like, say, like a pedophile or did sexual assault, he... at the same time kind of had his own duty to sort of like punch that guy out. It was pretty interesting. I subscribed to him pretty quickly.
This is Larry Lawton. A little piece, you put it over that, bend that end of the guitar string into that little plastic piece, and that will turn, and this thing will go back, and you have a tattoo. You literally have a tattoo. Now, what do you do for ink? You melt chess pieces. We would melt chairs, plastic chairs we'd melt. Also, the black guys in prison would buy hair grease off the commissary. So when they bought the higher hair grease, they would burn it, and black soot would come up, and catch that on loosely, put that into...
Yeah, you don't even need to watch. You can just listen.
And that would be the ink.
It's like a podcast, pretty much.
I mean, I watched the guy get MRSA from that and die. He was in prison. They don't give a shit about health care at all. And so he actually...
actually died in prison, and that blows me away. So back and out, I get out of the hole in Atlanta, and kind of funny story, but a serious story. I go to DU. I'm in the DU to TV room watching. You're not supposed to be there, but everybody went everywhere in Atlanta. It was a zoo. So I'm in DU, and I'm with a bunch of the Italian guys, and we're watching. Matter of fact, that was Vicarini.
Chris Mann's having his lunch.
Watching TV in the TV room. I got my chair up against the back wall. And there's a guy in front of us. We know him, but nothing big. So in comes a dude, and he stabs this dude in the neck. Bam! He stabs
him. Rehab program. See, I didn't... I don't think I've seen that. I don't think I've seen the one with the rehab program. Yeah, what happens to pedophiles in prison? That's the one right there. They hate me because I knew the law. Yeah. Yeah, but at any rate, his videos are very interesting. It's just a good listen. I'd recommend it to anybody. Absolutely. Anyhow, I did have a phone call I have to make, so I'm just going to drop out of this stream here. Just set up someone to host. Let's go with Scritties, huh? Why not? Why not? Alright, Cheeky. Thanks for hanging out. It was a good waste of time. It's probably like, what, 8, 9 o'clock at night for you? So, you have yourself a good evening. Yeah, it was a good waste of time. It was fun. No pressure. Just fucking around. So you're 7 hours ahead of me. Alright, so, just gonna swing it all over to Scribbies, and, I'll catch you later.